So they're all here to answer your questions. That being said, I'll get us started. First off, how are you all? All right?
Great.
Good, good to hear. David, if anyone goes into this thinking they're going to see a typical World War II film, they're in for a bit of a shock, aren't they?
Yeah, they're wrong.
Okay, just flat wrong. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just flat wrong. It's a unique animal. You know, most World War II films are about a battle. This is about a family. This is about a family that happens to live in a tank and kill people. It's a day in the life. It's a slice of life. It's a character study. It's about these guys and their chemistry and their brotherhood and the love they have for each other.
Michael, you've obviously made a film with David before. What made you want to come back? What's he like to work for?
What I'm like working with David is like going, like getting a root canal.
Put that on your CV, David.
You know the date.
Yeah.
You know it's gonna suck, and then like you just prepare for it the best you can.
I'm taking applications now. By the way,
it's not easy. It sucks.
Brad, what did you make of War Daddy when you first read the script? Did you get a lot of backstory from David?
Yeah, I got a lot of backstory. I got endless emails at like 3 a.m, just a barrage of a backstory that never makes the film, but certainly informs the character. You know, talking to any of the vets, they constantly painted this picture of the exhaustion, the fatigue, the mental fatigue, the cold, the hunger, the accumulative effect of seeing trauma and horror and inflicting horror on a daily basis. And that was, we took that to heart and begin the film in that state.
Mm-hmm. Logan, your character Norman kind of goes through the same journey as the audience, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does. I mean, he is kind of the eyes into this world, into their world, and their relationship and family dynamic, and
John, was there, you mentioned the sort of level of commitment. Was there ever a point during the kind of like the boot camp phase where you thought, this is too full on for me?
Yeah, I mean, I think that was kind of the point for each of us to sort of break down in our own special way, and I think it did happen for all of us, but you know, the genius of the boot camp and Kevin Vance, our technical advisor, was that once we sort of discovered each other's strengths and weaknesses and we figured out how to use our strengths and help each other with our weaknesses, we really became a team and a family, and that was essential for our first day of work. We were a family, we were a team.
I just wanted to ask for David, it seemed like in this movie that for the first time in a while in a World War II movie, the Allies were shown to have a lot of aggression and almost ruthlessness. Was this always intentional to sort of show the conflicting moral dilemma in war?
You know, it's a convention of the genre to show this very sort of clean, choreographed fighting. You know, the conflict itself, you know, truly was this battle between good and evil. You know, either we're going to have human rights and freedom or utter debasement. And people often project the moral clarity of the conflict itself into the daily lives of the soldier, which is not the case. For the soldier on the ground or in the tank turret, it was incredibly morally murky, just like any conflict has ever been. You know, and you can look at you know, literature, Red Badge of Courage, All Quiet on the Western Front also explores those same themes. I just wanted to make a film that spotlighted the moral hazards, the psychic hazards of war itself, and the impression it leaves on the human soul, and how it affects this family of brothers.
I just wanted to ask, there's a lot discussed about post-traumatic stress disorder. These men are clearly damaged in war, at which the film deals with very respectfully, and I just wondered, as performers, how important was it for you to bring that kind of truth? If I must start with Mr. Pitt, please.
It was precisely that. Again, it's the picture they painted. It's the same story that Dave just mentioned in All Quiet on the Western Front, that the soldier experience seems to be, the standard issue soldier experience seems to be the same on either side. So this was, again, not a film about sides and who's winning what. This, for me, was a film about that accumulative psychic trauma, that dent in the psyche that every soldier carries to some extent, endures, and is then meant to come home with.
Yes, in the blue there.
I just want to add one other thing to that. There's, if anyone's interested, there's a fantastic book that helped me a lot on the subject, and it's by Lieutenant Colonel Dave Grossman. It's called On Killing, and he lays it out better than anyone.
So we've come to the end of the London Film Festival. This year we've been bookended by two films regarding World War II, The Imitation Game and now Fury. I'm just wondering what it means to all of you to be closing the festival with such an unflinching film depicting the carnage of war.
I mean, for me, it's a privilege to be here. It's a privilege to close a festival. You know, we shot in the UK, and it just brings great closure to the process. 1 year ago today, we were shooting some of these very battle scenes. So it's just, it's a privilege.
I was wondering how your relationship was off camera, because in the movie, you're a bit like a mentor for him.
Yeah, sure. You know, in pre-production, we all became very close and got to know each other very well. And then we started the movie, and it was almost, you know, the start of a new relationship. I would say there was a lot of distance for respect. We emulated, I guess, our relationships in the movie in a way, which was, there was a lot of conflict. So I guess there was a lot of conflict on set. But it was always that thing. I was the new guy and the liability, and that's the way I was treated.
In a good way. You got to understand, you know, when the film starts, we've been together, our crew has been together for, you know, 3.5 years, and we just lost our fifth member of our family. And at that point, a new kid comes in, and it's that time in the war where, you know, there wasn't the survival rate of a tank crew was not so good, and at that point they were having to pull people off the lines with no experience and throw them in the tanks, and we have to harden him very quickly. We got to get him to function, or we may not be going home. The conundrum of it is, you know, the Norman character comes in with everything we value at home, civility, ideals, and everything that we're missing and lost and long for, but at the same time, it has to be crushed because we got to get him to perform.
This is a question for probably the members of the cast. We do get some glimpses of the character's past, but we don't get a CV of where they come from. We get like blurred half lines and all that. Was there a point in your finding out what your characters were before the war, or was it where you just thrown into your characters as it were during the war? Mm.
No, we all had very specific backstories. We worked a good 3 months at least, probably more, before the camera even started rolling, together and singularly. Mm-hmm. You guys want to add anything?
Yeah, I'll jump into that. Each character had a very defined backstory. You know, Logan knew where he came from, what his father did, how he was raised, his childhood, his education. Every character had an incredibly detailed CV and past. There are a few scenes in the scripts that did detail specifically some of those character backstories. Ultimately became a directorial choice to sort of cut out the classic, now I'm going to tell the audience who these people are stuff, and create defined enough portraits. I mean, had their performances not been as outstanding as they are, I probably would have had to have placed those scenes into the movie in order to make them empathetic to the audience. It's a testament to their ability as actors that they're able to bring these dimensional characters to the screen that we didn't need the standard issue, let me tell you who everybody is stuff.
What do you hope that cinemagoers will take away from this movie once they've seen it? What effect do you hope it will have upon them?
Well, I mean, first I hope, you know, our wish is the soldiers themselves walk away and feel that they were respectfully recognized and there's truth in it. You know, war is hell. Talking to the vets and even vets who are recently home, one guy said, listen, war is ludicrous. If you look at it, it's ludicrous, so you don't. And it is an amazing fact of human nature that one year we could be chopping each other up and the next year be sharing a pint. We seem to often continually devolve into conflict no matter how much we evolve. And I think this film represents that. Individually. I mean, I partially just answered that but it is true. We can talk and we better ourselves, but yet we seem to slip back into conflict. Always. I mean, always.
You know, just for that, I would say also, I think there's a universality to soldiering that was uniform in all the soldiers we had the privilege to talk to. And that really was that at the end of the day, for the most part, people don't go to war for, you know, political ideals or personal philosophies. At the end of the day, you're there fighting for the guy next to you and for the guys who have become your family there. And I think that's something that we really, really wanted to get in touch with. And I hope that comes across in the movie. I think that's kind of the point.
What's fascinating about World War II is, whereas today we have an all-volunteer army and career cadre of professional soldiers staffing that army, you know, at the senior NCO and officer levels, in World War II, it really was our neighbors, our friends were drafted into this conflict. So the men that fought this war, the men that bore the brunt of the fighting, were everyday people who in their lifetime, growing up, adolescence, never imagined themselves in these situations. The warrior is in all of us, I believe, and it's just a question of circumstances when that warrior is awakened.
Just a question to David and to Brad, really, about how you went about assembling your band of brothers. Was there any of the parts written with anyone specific in mind, or how did they come on board?
In the writing phase, normally I try not to envision any specific actor because I like the characters to sort of reveal themselves in that process. I wrote the role of Gordo with Mike in mind. We had worked together on that. you know, as he indicated, I'm not the easiest person to work for. So specifically, I created a role that's complex, nuanced, with a lot of shades, and he had to do his work and find quite a bit of that and bring that to the screen. Brad read the script, wanted in, and I was honored to have him. We had met before and discussed working together, and it was an honor to finally find that project. And after that, it really became about building the family and finding the right brothers to round this out, the right chemistry. And not only that, but casting these gentlemen who had a level of commitment above and beyond, not only time commitment, but also a willingness to expose himself to hardship and difficulties that actors aren't typically asked to participate in.
One, I was kind of given an honorary degree as producer on this one. Most of these guys did the heavy lifting. I take a lot from this film. I mean, the greatest thing an actor can experience is discovery. The greatest thing an artist can walk away is to learn something about themselves and about the world. And this was one of those for all of us. I know I speak for all of us on that front. We all walked away absolutely enriched. And for me specifically, it was a real study in leadership, in earning one's respect, and and being responsible for others, and I walk away knowing I'm a better father because of the experience.
I wanted to ask, actually, with it being such an immersive experience as actors, did you find it harder than usual to transition back to normal life, like when you rapped?
No, it's a fair question. Anyone want to jump in?
Yeah, I absolutely. I think we all did. I think. Look, at the end of the day, we put on makeup and say lines. You know, we operate under this umbrella of safety. You know, where there's not real bullets being shot at us. But up until that, you know, it's our job to make this as dark and dangerous a set as possible, and to be in a mindset that's as dark and dangerous as possible. And this was not the kind of movie that, you know, you wrap and you go get a beer, you go have a nice night on the town or get Chinese food. You know, you literally just wrap and you fight or you work out and you sleep and you try to stay in it. And any outside influence, you know, computers and phones or anything like that, they were the enemy. So I think that when you're trying to make your world as dark as possible for, you know, 8 months straight, it's definitely, you know, going home after that, it is tough. And what I walk away with from that is just, again, absolute reverence and respect for guys who have real battle, you know, ringing between their ears, you know, and they go home. Because, yeah, it had a big effect on me. And again, you know, I'm a monkey who wears makeup, you know.
Because of that responsibility, I suppose that it feels like you all experienced. Do you think it's the most demanding project that you've done as an actor, Shia or Logan?
Definitely the most demanding project. It was the most committed project in terms of last year. I mean, I could say that I was looking for a really good challenge, and after reading this script, it was this or nothing. So dedicated pretty much all of last year to this project, as did everybody else, really. And that's what David was looking for. And in doing that, we had, you know, great time to do research on a very detailed level and really get to know one another, which is the most important aspect, I think, to pre-production, is getting to know the people you're working with on a very personal level, and building that comfort. Yeah, it was definitely the most dedicated film process I've ever, you know, been a part of.
Might be the wrong choice of word, but did you enjoy it, Shia?
Oh yeah, this has been the most rewarding, incredible experience of my life, both in work and in life. Extremely rewarding and really magical moment for me in my life.
I just wanted to ask, I mean, we've seen a lot of submarine movies, not so many tank movies. What were the logistics of filming, or at least giving the illusion of filming in a confined space, and what was it like for the actors?
We built the interior set, modeled it after, obviously, the Sherman tank, upscaled the blueprints about 10%, and then kitted it out with all the proper equipment that it would have. The turret turn, the gun loaded and ejected shells, the machine guns fired, the radio transmitted and received. I don't know who we talked to, but it worked. Everything worked in there, and it was actually one of the most technically complex sets anyone on that film crew had worked on. It was utterly maddening to film in for me. I'm a shooter. I like to get lots of coverage, and I would just go in the corner and cry while they took about 2 hours to light the thing with these teeny little bespoke LED lights, dozens of them stashed throughout this to give it that beautiful look it has. I don't know if any of us enjoyed working in it, but maybe that did help. Some of the tension that's felt on screen. I'll let these guys talk about what it was like to work inside of it. I never really had to go in it. Mm.
First of all, there's nothing ergonomical about a tank. It's not made for habitation in any way. There's no steps to get up it or down it. You get inside, you can The turret rings, or you got an appendage out, it'll take it right off. You can lose your fingers bringing the lid down. You're always getting banged up on something. But there comes this point, as we were forced to familiarize ourselves with it, with the tank, where we all found our little comfort spots, you know, between the bolt and the turret ring, and you knew your coffee wouldn't vibrate off right here. You could put the coffee there. Cold instant coffee, by the way. We were method.
Nescafe.
Nescafe. and we became quite proprietary over our tank. It was our home, and you think of the real guys that, you know, who lives in it. They literally sleep, eat, crap, fight, all of it inside the confines of this tin can.
It was interesting for me because, you know, when you shoot a film, between setups, the actor is supposed to go to his trailer and hang out and make calls and do whatever they do in there. Brad would stay inside of the tank on set. So I got very good at climbing up the tank because to give him notes, I'd have to scramble up the thing to talk to him. And he'd always be just kind of relaxed inside. He got very comfortable. And he's about 13 feet in the air. And it was like his eagle's nest. He would gaze down upon us working and sort of stay in character that way.
It was the best view.
I have a question for the director. As a German woman who was brought up on a diet of horrific stories from her mother and grandmother of what they actually went through in the last few months of the war and immediately afterwards, mm-hmm. and especially kind of encounters with Allied forces, I found it personally very harrowing mm-hmm. and very suspenseful to include a part in the movie which is not about warfare, but about the dynamics between the German occupied people and the Allied soldiers. Why did you feel it was important to include that in this movie? I thought it was extremely well done, by the way.
Thank you. It's a very interesting chapter in history. During the last portion of that war, the United States Army, we're not liberators, we're occupiers. We're invading a country. An interesting anecdote from the armored forces, one veteran had said that once they crossed the border into Germany, a German soldier who was captured told them, you're no longer fighting the Nazis, now you're fighting the German people. Something interesting about that mindset. It was a different world back then and a different time. You had an army that was exhausted. You had an army that had been fighting for several years on both sides. And the depictions of the war of civilians being thrown into battle, children being thrown into battle as the regime sort of fell apart. But the purpose of that scene in the film was really to shine a spotlight on how much these men had changed, how they could never go home. Brad's character, desperate for this human connection in normalcy, is not allowed that by the other members of his crew. It's a very complex scene. It was one of the most difficult ones to photograph. And Alicia von Ritter and Anna Marinka, incredible work that they did in preparation. It's very nuanced and layered, but again, there's something fascinating about that apocalyptic time period in the occupation. Either you're making films or you're making videos. Digital capture is always trying to emulate the range and look of film. You know, they say the Area Lex has something like in test 14 stops of dynamic range. I believe personally film has more. We decided to shoot on film, tested various platforms. Our initial test was on film. There's such a subtle palette in the uniforms and the patina in world that we created in design that when you did tests on digital, you ended up with these crushy blacks in these very muddy greens that didn't have the differentiation that one has with film. Shot on 35, G-series lenses, which is an older lens set from the early 80s. True Romance was shot on G-series, another example of a film with those. We treated the final image when we did the DI as film. So instead of taking the digital scans and then pushing the data around and doing whatever with it, we were very careful to apply traditional film lights as you would in a lab in traditional film curves on this. And that, is, I think, is a bit different. So ultimately, we ended up with this nice even saturation. It's not oversaturation. And these open blacks. And film loves skin. Film loves textures. I'm sorry, and I love film. I mean, film is an incredible medium.
For me, there's no difference. I'm game for either, and I'm a purist. I love film, but also on the other hand, there are guys who are starting to discover their own thing with digital. They're not trying to emulate film digitally. They're finding its own look and its own voice. And I appreciate that as well. But when he made the film call, we're going film. I was happily pleased inside.
Okay, a couple more questions. Yeah, over here.
Hi, Chris from Belgium. Two questions for Brad. By coincidence, your wife also made a World War II film. Did you sometimes exchange research? And second part...
Yeah, it was actually a lovely experience. We don't normally work at the same time, and we just got our schedules all cocked up, so we ended up... It ended up this way. But it was nice. We were both, you know, I was studying the European theater. She was studying the Pacific theater. I was studying tanks. She was studying bombers. And it was good fun for us. You know, where we deal with the psychic damage of the soldier, her film focuses on the triumph of the human spirit.